Hello everyone, I am Avishkar Gandhi and I welcome you all on to the another episode. So today we have a special person. She is none other than Rashi Thakran. Ma'am have achieved such a huge milestone at such a young age. She has broke all the stereotypes and have been the successful person in her life and have achieved great milestones at such a young age of 22. She's ma'am is mental health advocate, writer, QPR instructor, as well as public speaker. We welcome you, ma'am.
Thank you so much for having me. You're so kind. Yeah. Thank you.
So, ma'am, we will begin with the first question. How is meditation important to stay calm in today's world?
All right. So, meditation, honestly, for me, I am not a lot into meditation because I tried that a couple of times. But for me, it's usually, you know, when I meditate, it gets very, very quiet. And it's supposed to get very quiet, yes. But that's when a lot of thoughts start coming in my head. So, you know, for me, it hasn't, like, I haven't been very much into meditation, but definitely what I do is, so my form of meditation, and that's something that has really helped me, is, you know, deep breathing, just sitting down and taking deep breaths. And I think that is so important to just help you calm down, because I struggle with anxiety. And for anyone who gets very anxious or who is suffering from anxiety and all of these other mental health issues, I think deep breathing in that moment really helps. It really orients you. And another thing that I do as part of my meditation, if you can call it that, is a grounding technique that my therapist told me about. And I think it has really helped me get through some really tough times. So again, when things get really overwhelming, these grounding techniques, for example, it's just about closing your eyes. So very similar to being in that moment and meditating. And you just think about the five different, just activate your five different senses. And that's how you ground yourself. And that really helps you with, you know, maybe your heart is beating too fast, so it calms you down. It, again, it gives you some sort of a relief. So that's meditation for me. And I think it is so important. It is important to just sit and be with yourself for a moment. And I think that's what meditation is.
So next question we will have that, how has life changed from going to the college and now influencing and motivating people? So how has been the transformation?
Wow. It honestly, it hasn't been very different. To be honest, I miss college. I really miss all my friends, and I was in an engineering college, so, you know, we did everything apart from studying, and I think that's how it is in you would know.
Yeah.
So that's how colleges are, and I think I really miss doing that. But again, being here in the mental health field, working towards this cause, has also had it's been a life-changing experience for me. I have met some amazing people, and be it online as well as offline. So both online and offline, I've met amazing people. I have had the honor of collaborating with these people, learning so much from them, because I am from an engineering background, so I did not know a lot about, let's say, psychology or mental health in general. So it's just like I'm learning on the job, and through this, I'm you know, gaining a lot of perspective, meeting so many mental health professionals. So it's been great. Honestly, I think in a way, I found my purpose, which is amazing.
Yeah, that's really great. So next question, I would like to ask that, do you think that mental health is being ignored nowadays according to the situation and the trends we are seeing in today's world?
Yeah, so I think on the contrary, people are talking about mental health a little more now. It's coming to the forefront. I mean, as compared to earlier, obviously there's a long way to go. I'm not saying that it's completely fine now, and you know, we've achieved what we wanted to achieve with mental health, because even now a lot of policies are not in place, and in terms of the government giving it due attention, that's not happened. So our government, our policymakers, they have not yet realized the importance, I guess. But I think when it comes to people, when it comes to our generation, we are being more vocal, we are spreading awareness, we are especially right now during this pandemic, we are trying to help each other out. There's so many new initiatives that are starting. So again, mental health has been getting a lot of attention, and it's a much deserved attention. It's something that it deserves. So honestly, I'm really happy with where we're going right now, where we're headed. And I really, really hope that, you know, we keep doing this. We keep, you know, the conversation alive. And at the same time, I really hope that our policymakers and our government and the people who are in positions of power, they also join hands with us. And we're able to, you know, do something huge.
Okay. Yeah, let's hope that government makes the law soon.
Yeah, yes. And not just making the law, even like with the existing laws. For example, we have the Mental Health Act, which was, it came into being in 2017. But, you know, on ground, it hasn't been implemented really. So it's there on paper, but that's all it is. Implementing those laws which you already have in place is, I think, the first priority that the government should give. But, you know, right now they have, you know, their priorities are different, I think, but I'm really hoping that, you know, this also comes on that list of priorities.
Yeah, sure. Just a question, after this such a huge, like, good answer given by you, that what was the actual reason of signing the petition and launching the nationwide helpline, which you did through the other mediums, through your social media, right? And
So last year, actually, that's when I launched my petition in July. And the petition basically asked the government, the health ministry to be exact, to launch a national helpline number for suicide prevention. And this happened because of a personal loss and a personal tragedy that I experienced last year, in the beginning of last year. I lost my younger brother to suicide, and that's when, you know, I obviously for the first couple of months, it was it's just, I don't even remember, it was a blur. But when I did come back to my senses, and I realized that, you know, this is such a huge issue in our country, not just in our country, it's everywhere, all over the world. Honestly, this is a pandemic. It takes so many lives every day. But we are still not, trying, like, we're not addressing the elephant in the room, that is, you know, mental illnesses and these suicides which are happening every day, especially among young people. So I realized that, you know, my brother was in so much pain that this seemed like, you know, the only solution for him. And obviously, I couldn't do anything at that time. I couldn't help my brother. But if through this petition, if through, you know, the work that I do, if I'm able to save even a single person, that would be a huge thing. And I think with this thought in my head, I decided to apply for the Change.org fellowship. And this fellowship is called the She Creates Change program. And I got selected for it. And with them, I launched this petition. So again, it was all about, you know, completely changing courses. I was in my final year of engineering back then in 2019. And I had a job, and I was supposed to join last year itself. But I just knew that, you know, this is not where my heart lies. This is not what I want to do. I want to work in the field of mental health. I want to do something towards this cause. So I think that was the driving force, and that's how my petition came into being, and you know, it became a huge success. Obviously, after the petition, we got the government to also notice, and they also had a meeting with us, and they even launched a couple of helpline numbers during this time. So overall, it's been a great journey. It's been huge. We still don't we still don't have a proper national helpline number. So that's something that is still on my agenda, and that will never be over until we get a dedicated helpline number. But yeah, a lot has happened since then, which has been great.
So yeah. Moving to another question, what methods do you generally suggest when the person DMs you or talk you on WhatsApp or any other social media? If he's in depression, or maybe he's in anxiety, he faces anxiety attack. Like in today's youth, it's quite common. They just suffer from more of the illness of anxiety attack. Like even if the person fails in exam, he just thinks that suicide is the only way. Like we have seen in the Chichore about the same. So what generally methods you suggest or therapies you suggest to get the person back on the track and motivate him?
So honestly, I think the first thing that I say to them is that I'm not a mental health professional. I am not qualified to, you know, give them therapy and give them advice. That's number one. And that's the most important thing, because I'm not qualified enough to, you know, do that. There are a lot of mental health professionals who have studied for years and years, researched for years and years, and then they, you know, they have also practiced it. So then they are qualified enough to, you know, do that. So whenever someone comes to me, and a lot of people come to me, I think they mistake me for a professional. So I get that a lot. But that's the first thing that I tell them, that, you know, I'm here for you and I will listen to you. But I'm not a mental health professional. So I'm not going to give you any advice. What I can do is just help you with things that have helped me. So I can tell you what has helped me. For example, I suffered. If someone comes to me that, you know, they have depression or they have anxiety, that's something that I've struggled with as well. So I tell them that, yes, this is what my therapist suggested. And, you know, medications helped me and I went to the doctor. So I would suggest them to go to the doctor as well. And what I can help with are resources. So I will tell them that, you know, I do this. I say that, you know, I have these resources. I'm not qualified to give you therapy, but I know people who are. And I would love to direct you to them, and you can reach out to them, and they are, you know, people who I can vouch for. So I will not give you any contacts which I don't know about and I'm not sure about, because again, that's not ethical. So I tell them that these are people I can vouch for. You reach out to them. Even, you know, if sometimes I help them with the appointments, I tell them that, you know, and it's really important to just be there with them, follow up with them. Even if it's possible, if the situation permits, even go to the appointment with them. Because a lot of times these people they don't even have the energy to, you know, book an appointment and go to that appointment alone, all by themselves. So I think that's how I try to tackle the situation. That's how I try to. And I definitely, what I can do best is listen to them. And listening really, really helps a person, because sometimes all someone wants to do is just vent out. And they don't have anyone to, you know, hear them out. So that's what I do. I think attentive listening, active listening, and keeping myself equipped with all the resources is how I try to help them.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes, thank you so much for having me. Please take care. Stay safe.